valid,
and then valid go on to assertment. How do I want them to feel?
Assertion.
Assertion. There we go.
Go insert a mint, Jim.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, and Chris turn an old discussion on its head and explore the idea that sometimes developers don't know what they want. Plus, the Dresden Files cooperative card game, the return of elevator pitch, and more. The Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode 121 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast. Games and new media with a splash of academia. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, guys.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And today's a interesting discussion. It's going to be a little bit of a spin on something we've talked about before, which we'll actually have in one of our opening segments. The idea that gamers don't know what they want. This is a rather infamous quote that a Blizzard developer made a while back that we actually talked about on the show. But today we're talking about developers not knowing what they want.
You may think that's a dumb topic, but you don't know what you want.
And we'll sort of get into it once we introduce that topic, kind of more what we're talking about there. But it's things like tendencies we've seen recently in the games industry that we think indicate maybe a need for a shift in thinking as far as developers, how developers approach the making of their games.
Or a start in thinking. I don't know.
So it should be quite an interesting discussion, a little reversal on things. But first, we have some opening segments for you, including the Button Mosh.
Get ready for the Button Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
So I had a chance to pick up the new, or maybe I should say rather old, Age of Empires 2 Definitive Edition. This is the digital remake of the classic AoE 2.
When was that first released?
Oh, goodness. Well, I know I played it back in college, so it must have been the 90s.
Like late 90s, early 2000s.
Yeah, it's in the 90s. Yeah. And Age of Empires 2 is one of my favorite real-time strategy games. I mean, I love that game.
I agree. I don't think it's been topped, frankly. I think it was that perfect balance of, finding lots of different races and abilities and all that sort of thing. Persians still can't be stopped with elephants, that kind of a thing. Build a wonder, you can win. But the beauty of it really came whenever you had a group of people that you knew who were all into it.
Yes.
Enough, good enough to be able to
play together.
And you could play together in that time when a LAN was a big deal. You know what I'm saying?
I remember I played it in college too.
Yeah.
LAN connection between different people in the dorm.
We'd all go to the computer lab or whatever, you know? Okay. So, here's the thing. It's been updated with new graphics that look like the old graphics. I've talked about this in the past. I remember things that were low res in HD because I had a really good imagination.
Oh no, I'm with you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always shocking sometimes when you see old graphics.
Yeah. So this game is exactly like I remember it,
but not how it looked,
as it never was.
Right. Kind of like StarCraft, the new HD StarCraft.
That's a perfect example. So there's not much I can say about this, except that if you missed the onset and the coming of this, the advent has arrived. It is here, and it's good. And it's a really good price, too. And there's a couple of the original expansions have been done, too. And here's the big deal, a new content expansion that has just been created specifically for this release.
Ah, interesting.
And that's exciting. So for a minor investment, let's call it $35-$40, you can get the full package and play with your friends and do, you know, like you did before. I recommend doing that through Steam. It's a great way to do it. And really, there's nothing bad that I can say about the game. It is still as polished and balanced as it was. The Persians are still undefeatable.
I find it interesting because my experience with the game was the British, the English longbowmen were broken.
Mm-hmm.
But the way, the true way that you win is with paladins, because paladins could do anything. So what you do is you they could destroy buildings.
Mm-hmm.
They were incredible tanks, and they actually were able to tank the longbowmen and get there. Because the trick with the longbowmen was you would put them far enough away that none of the towers could actually hit them.
Mm-hmm.
But they had such range they could fire over your walls and destroy your buildings.
Gotcha.
The only way to stop them was with the paladins. So I would always play France and buff my paladins, and I didn't lose.
So I will say this. with the group I've been playing with,
yeah,
we've actually been playing with the beta patch, which is the sort of fan-made new rebalancing of those sorts of things. So the top criticisms of what was always quote-unquote broken has been leveled out a little bit. And I think they've done a very, very good job of it. And if nothing else, it brings in that mystery of, is this going to work? That original 90s era, is this going to work kind of a thing.
It's not just like the, hey, I'm going to use the dominant strategy that's emerged after 20 years of meta.
Exactly. and to me, that's what, like, if you go back and you play the original StarCraft, you're not playing the same game. You're playing a completely different game. And this where all the Dotas and things like that, you know, came out of the Warcrafts and whatnot. So to me, I think it's the right kind of fresh. But there are certain things that aren't recreated, and that's like, for example, lag and being dropped from a game in those original 90s connections. And that in and of itself is totally worth it.
Awesome.
So, give it a whirl. Go look up Age of Empires 2, the definitive edition, and give it a whirl.
This is Back Talk, where someone shares new thoughts on a previous discussion.
We have a back talk segment where we're sort of leads into our meaty topic, and the quote was a little bit when Chris gave the quote, let's call it more of a paraphrase than a quote.
Fair.
So give it a little background here. The actual quote here, this is coming from Blizzard's production design or production director.
This is back when we were talking to Richard about developer and player relations, right?
Yeah, this is a couple.
Richard Worth, yeah.
Yeah, so this was a couple years ago. In relation to the, so give a little context. There's been people within the World of Warcraft community that have been pushing for, that have been complaining, I should say, about all of the expansions changing the core game and all the core mechanics,
right,
so significantly that the game simply isn't fun anymore. It's
the vanilla game they remember.
Yes. Well, and the vanilla game that some of them still play.
The 2004 version.
Yes. And that some of them actually still play on personal servers, which you actually can set up.
Yeah.
They wanted to bring in more and more people. And to do that, they had to, in their opinion, they had to change the game so that it was more accessible.
Right.
And in doing so, they alienated some of their core base. And so the comment of, oh, you think you do, but you don't, was taken as a direct affront to a direct attack to their core audience.
Yeah, but in defense
of... I'm not saying it was meant that way. I'm saying that's why it was taken that way.
In defense of the WoW developers, who, of course, had a big meeting before this statement was publicly... No, they didn't at all. It was an offhanded comment.
And let's also clarify that the people that were behind this statement were not the people that made World of Warcraft. They were people that were currently on the World of Warcraft team. The World of Warcraft team that actually designed the game is no longer with the company.
That's very
true. It hasn't been for some time. But, so that's another reason why this comment was taken that way.
Sure. The intellectual property, which is represented by the World of Warcraft world, gives them, by which I mean Blizz, the, let's say, authority, uniquely the authority to be able to say, we have the metrics, we have the entire history. It's private information that we have kept for ourselves. We've never published it. We're never going to, because we're a privately owned company, but we have the data that shows that even though this seems like it would be a thing that would be successful, it actually would not be a thing that would be successful.
Right. And I think, and if they had said it in a way like that, I don't think it would have had the negative connotations attached to it, because really what they were saying and what they should have said was that this is a business decision.
Right.
The sort of people that want the vanilla experience are the hardest core
mm-hmm.
of their audience. They're right. and just by saying that, by the nature of being a hardcore fan of this style of game, there's not going to be many of you.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be much more of the casual audience. And so they're simply they believed there simply wasn't enough people to justify this. Now, that being said, right, there was enough outcry and there was enough push and there was enough, you know, pushback from this that they are actually going to have legacy servers.
Which is kind of ironic because if there hadn't been an outcry, I don't think enough people would have been interested or aware to want to do it. You know what I'm saying?
That's a little tough to say. I mean, I would say that's speculative because I don't really know. And I don't know if
that's my opinion.
Right. Well, but I don't know if anyone really knows just how many people were pushing for it, because the ones that were pushing for it were doing so very loudly. But how many actually were is kind of hard to say.
Well, the audience model is actually something I've studied and written on. And if you use the upside down pyramid model or upside down triangle model, what you've got is about a 1 in 1,000, which would be considered the leaders, if you will, in the audience. And so they're the ones that are making the decisions, and a lot of others are actively participating or simply following along in that. But they're not actually making decisions or adjusting content. They're not having any kind of meaningful impact on the content. 1 in 1,000 is doing that-ish. But that said, I think if they had said something along the lines of, we really don't think that investing the time, the money, the infrastructure, and the personnel for bringing back a game that is now dated would be something that would work for the community.
Well, we just won't know at this point because we won't know until it releases. Apparently, give a little update on this. As of November of last year, so November 2017, they announced that they had started hiring for World of Warcraft Classic. So they are bringing in extra people to work on it, and they're probably shifting some resources within the company as well. So they're going to call, I refer to it as Legacy Server. I think that's actually the fan name for the unofficial servers. So they're actually going to call it World of Warcraft Classic. Now, what elements of the game are, like, what does that mean? What does that entail? Because all we've really seen is a trailer. So we don't even know exactly how far they're going to push that classic.
Yeah.
You know, so we'll have to see. So in terms of how successful it is, we don't know yet.
Yeah.
We'll have to see.
One of the questions I have about that now, actually, and this is something I was going to mention also, that, you know, beyond just the logistical thing behind getting it up and running and like the question of like, is this worth our time and resources? But also the developers probably have a sense of there were things that we fixed from back then that like we think were actually improvements that we went back to.
Could you name one thing that was fixed?
I can't.
I'll say this, the what they did was, it was very clever. They didn't fix things. What they did was they changed things to accommodate new content, and new content wouldn't work unless they changed the game in a certain way. And then when people complained about some of the things that they changed, which I think they did on purpose, they then added something new that addressed the problem.
Well, there were some legitimate bug fixes.
But bug fixes are not what people were complaining about when it comes to the changes to World of Warcraft with the expansions. It wasn't about bug fixes. It was always about the new things that they added. Like, for example, not liking the way that some of the new dungeons were set up, or not liking some of the new zones, or not liking things like the resilience system with armor and weapons that had, I forgot what it's called, armor penetration. Mm. So it was very specific mechanical changes that people were concerned about, not bug fixes.
Okay. And what I'm speaking of, just very broadly speaking,
who played the game for long periods of time.
I'm just speaking very broadly about like changes to systems, like the way they handle skills and like the way you change your builds and that sort of thing. Like those all evolved over time as the game kept going. And, you know, I'm sure the developers made conscious decisions about that. So part of that could also be that when people say they want to go back to the old way, people are always going to disagree with any change in the game, but they're probably saying like, we think that this is the best thing for the game. There are a lot of reasons why going back to the old way isn't the best idea. So I think that was also part of the comment there.
Yeah. You know, my own speculation on this is that the number one thing people really, really, really want to see again is the old maps before the Cataclysm happened.
Yes.
I think that that's really what their nostalgia glasses are remembering.
I think it's that, but I also think there's a big part of it of the way the loot system worked before and the way that armor worked before.
Sure. The original classes and the balance.
I don't think it can be understated how much adding resilience to armor changed the game and forced them to make other changes in order to fix, quote, that mistake. Mm-hmm. Because, which is where I don't know if it was actually called armor penetration, but it was something like that, was introduced specifically because of resilience. Mm-hmm. So they created a problem for themselves that they later had to fix. And I think those are some of the things that people are the most concerned with. And yes, it is the old maps too, because I think there were some disappointment with some of the new maps. I know Encourage being the biggest example. I was part of a group that unlocked Encourage, and it was the quest to unlock it was epic, and it was incredible, and it took, you know, several days or weeks. I know it felt like months, but I don't think it was anywhere near that long to collect all of these, you know, scarabs or something like that in order to unlock it. When you finally unlocked it and you get into this new dungeon, it was like this first new in-game dungeon that was introduced. Mm-hmm. The dungeon sucked. It was extremely disappointing. And that was before the first big expansion, you know, came out. And then with those, there was a lot of disappointment with Burning Crusade being the first one.
Yeah.
And each one kind of added more and more disappointment. Cataclysm, I think you're right. There was a lot of
pushback
for it. And I think part of it with that too is like they felt like they needed to change something to spice the game up, which I completely understand.
Yeah, but from a mechanical standpoint, yes, what they really did was they ported it over to a new engine so you could fly anywhere you wanted and various other things. Yes. It simply didn't work before. So I think, honestly, I think I have to agree with the devs on this one point. People are going to be like, woohoo, I'm in a classic server. Yay, I want my mount. I want my flying mount. Wait a minute, that's not implemented. And they're, I think, going to suddenly remember and realize that there's a lot of stuff that they loved about the new game and the new versions of the game and the later implementations of the game and the later this and that. It's not there. It was never there. And I think they're going to burn out hard and fast, and it's going to crash and burn, and that server is going to be gone and dead in just a few years.
And that brings me back to what I was kind of alluding to earlier, is like, I'm curious to what extent like World of Warcraft Classic is actually going to be like, there's a lot of things we go back to, but we also still like we hybridize maybe a few things. Yeah. We reimagine something. So it feels like the old thing, but it's not just like, here's exactly version 1.10.
It's going to be in the new engine. And obviously they're going to use the new engine. And I do think that I have to disagree with what you're saying, Doc, because I think they're going to present it as though it's a new game. It's not a new old game. Kind of like a HD remake of the original, right?
You know what?
An enhanced edition, essentially, which we've had a lot of those, because they're calling it, they're not calling it World of Warcraft, oh, here's the new servers. It's called World of Warcraft Classic. They're presenting it as a separate game experience. So I think that especially with the success of so many enhanced editions and remakes, one that you just plugged earlier, Age of Empires 2, that has become, you know, everything old is new again kind of concept. I think that it's actually going to be successful. And I think a lot of the people that were clamoring for this and pushing for it were people that either had already left World of Warcraft or were lax in their accounts and maybe don't play as much. So I think this is actually going to bring in people that currently are not really playing the game.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not really going to affect that aspect of it. They're going to be able to run both at the same time, and both can still be successful. We'll see what happens with it, but I am cautiously optimistic. I am not so sure I'm actually going to play, to be honest, because I don't know if I have time to play MMO in my life right now. Mm-hmm. But I think that it could possibly catch on and could, if they do it right, lead to another gaming phenomenon, which, let's be honest, Blizzard is still capable of producing that, even if I'm not a huge fan of their game content nowadays. They are still capable of that. Look at what they did with Overwatch, right? Mm-hmm. So they're capable of doing it. They're capable of having, you know, that sort of like level of fervor. And frankly, the current World of Warcraft doesn't have it, and it's not going to have it. I don't care what expansion they come out with. It's too late.
You mean War for Azeroth?
Yeah.
coming out this year?
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying, though. They're going to keep doing expansions, of course, and they're going to make money off of them, right?
Sure.
But it's not going to excite the gaming community to the point where like gamers are obsessed with it again. But coming out with World of Warcraft Classic and what that might be could excite the gaming community, even people that have never played World of Warcraft, right? Because it's going to feel like it's new, even though it's old.
You'll have a lot of people who are coming back to it being like, hey, this is World of Warcraft as I played it. Yes. You should play it and experience this along with me.
Right. And now we're going to see a different group of people getting into it. We're going to see, you know, Let's Plays and Twitch. And it's going to be, I think there's a real market here, and it's going to be a market less so because they're just wiping everything away and more so because they're treating it like a reboot.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
Okay, so once upon a time, there was an author named Jim Butcher. who wrote a series of novels called The Dresden Files.
Yes, I've read some of them.
They're pretty great.
Yeah, I like them.
I also highly recommend the graphic novels. I think they're wonderful adaptations. Yes. Very, very good visuals on this stuff.
The TV show is also an excellent adaptation.
No, it was not. It was a terrible knockoff and a horrible decision, and even Jim Butcher has said so. But I don't know if that's true. But fast forward a few, decades, frankly, and what we're talking about on this, what I will call adult Harry Potter, a mashup between Buffy the Vampire Slayer's Angel and Sam Spade, right? It's a detective series about a wizard for hire in Chicago. Very gritty, very noir, but modern, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I just love the characters and the richness and all of that, okay? And what we had come out, I guess it was early 2017, was a Kickstarter for a card game, which was the co-op card game by Evil Hat. I like Evil Hat. Mm-hmm. They're a cool company.
They're also the ones who published the role-playing game based on the Dresden Files.
Absolutely correct. Yeah. Which I left out. Huge, mega transmedia world for Dresden, mm-hmm. honestly. And Fate came out of Dresden. So, yeah. I mean, that's like the origin of like the use of Fate dice and everything. Really? It's amazing. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. The Dresden Files RPG was the first Fate game.
Oh, wow.
It sure was. Cool. So we're talking rich, deep history here for Dresden. Okay. And now what we've got is a company called Hidden Achievement. You can find out about them at hiddenachievement.com. And they have created the digital, let's call it app version of this card game, which was very well received last year. You can download it. You can download it for about $7 or $8. That's the core game. And then there's really four expansions beyond that. There's about $3 or $4 a piece. And there's one that's a little bit less content at the end. But what you end up with is if you spend about $20, $25, you can get the whole game. I recommend this right from the start.
Which is about the same price as buying the PC version of this game.
Right.
Which came out before the mobile version.
Yes, it sure did, actually. And about the same price as the tabletop card game analog, if you get that. Now, I will say one thing just to point it out. If you go down to the store and you buy the game, you're probably not going to get the Kickstarter exclusive version, which had all the additional content in it. You'd have to buy that extra. And you could actually end up spending pretty close to $100 for the analog tabletop game, or you can spend $20-$25 for the digital version. I strongly recommend doing that. The digital version is an incredibly faithful, incredibly strong adaptation and interpretation. For one reason more than any other, this game is very, very hard. Mm-hmm. It is incredibly hard to beat. And I think the major criticism of the app is this game is imbalanced, it's broken, you don't have enough fate points, all these kind of things. From somebody who, the people are saying that don't understand the purpose of this game. There's about 8 or 9 scenarios, and they're very much aligned with the stories that are written. And you choose a story, and you are meant to solve the mystery kind of almost in the same way that it was done in the books. One could even argue, to misquote a colleague, that reading the books is cheating. And what that would mean is that you, and within the context of the co-op, right, you all have different powers and cards, and you're trying to strategize without table talking the best way to play points so that they come off of the board. Now, there's 4 types of cards that are out there for the scenario. You've got things you need to attack, mysteries that need to be solved with clues. You've got advantages that you can take with take advantage cards. And you've also got obstacles, which you can overcome with overcome cards. That's basically it. But every character has their own special abilities. They have their own stunts. And it really changes based on who you bring in and how you try to do it. So there's a couple of different ways you can play this.
The game is actually pitched around kind of like it's the ultimate what if scenario.
Yes.
Because sometimes you get to play with characters that weren't present in those books.
They hadn't even been introduced yet.
And so it's like,
yet.
What happens if this character was able to do this thing at this time?
Michael's my favorite character, by the way. I absolutely love him. And his...
He's the like paladin type guy.
Yeah,
right?
He is. Yeah. And at the very beginning, I love him as an opening move because you can throw 3 attack points on a thing and move it to the end and it's out of your way. Mm-hmm. And it gives you sort of a free, let's move the cards around and also let's throw some attack down and also the other things. Everything has a modifier. All the scenarios are very slightly different. I could talk literally just a whole podcast about this game and how it works, but I won't do that. Instead, I will say this, okay? This is my strong recommendation for you. If you choose to play this and play this solo, do not play in solitaire mode. Okay. Instead, what I would strongly recommend that you do is that you actually go to 2-player mode.
Okay? Like pass and play.
Pass and play 2-player mode and select it in such a way so that you have 4 characters that you are playing. What will happen then is you have 2 character cards for each side that you play. And you will have twice as many cards in your hand. So this is the standard rules for 2-player in pass and play. But if you play by yourself as both sides of those, what it's going to give you is a slight advantage to be able to use the stunts and abilities of one or the other character as you like with a total of 4 characters. But what it disables is your ability to see the cards on the other side. So you have to sort of improve your memory. Like, I'm going to remember what cards I had in my other hand. Okay. I strongly recommend this. I played for about 4 days straight. Every evening I would play for 3 or 4 hours until I beat every single scenario using that method on easy. And now I'm going back through and playing it on standard.
Okay? Standard is hard.
Standard is very hard.
I actually haven't won yet.
It sure is. So that's my recommendation. And just for fun, what I would do is I started the first scenario. And then when I finally beat it, I went to the second one and so on and so on and so on. What I would do then is I would just let it be random. Like I wouldn't pick my characters. I'd let it just be. And so eventually I got to the point where the random roll in combination with the random deal, in combination with my own strategy and learning that scenario, because that's half the fun. You learn the scenario and you realize, oh, I got to beat it in this order. And then when you read the book, you're like, that totally makes sense why that had to happen before this had to happen. So it's almost like it's narrative spoilery in terms of the meta narrative for the books themselves. But anyway, that universe, the Dresden universe, is super fantastic. Highly recommend the game, but it is incredibly hard. And think of it as classic solitaire, you know, with a standard deck of cards. You don't play this game to win every time. And when you do win, you celebrate. Mm-hmm. You might deal out 15, 20 times and not win. Mm-hmm. So it's not about winning every time. It's not that type of game. It's the type of game where you're like, oh, I was so close that time. In fact, there's what's called at the end, the showdown. You take your extra points and you sort of, you buy dice to try to roll against certain cards. And there's a strategy to the showdown. And at the end of that showdown, I find is a lot of times whenever the win is said or done. Mm-hmm. In fact, if you win before the showdown, you usually get an achievement.
Yeah.
So anyway, Dresden, give it a shot. Totally worth the money. But don't expect to win. Mm-hmm. Be excited when you do.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
So this is an interesting phenomenon I've experienced recently. I as we've talked about before, I'm really a big fan of Audible and listening to audiobooks, and that's kind of been one of the main ways I pass time when I'm driving or walking or doing whatever else. And recently I've been reading through or listening through the Expanse series of novels.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Dresden Files.
So it's the series that starts off with, I think it's...
Leviathan Wakes.
Leviathan Wakes, yep, is the first book in the series. And of course, this is also now a sci-fi series based on the novels.
Yeah, the channel, sci-fi.
And I wanted to make sure I read through all the novels that are out so far before I watched the show, because I kind of wanted to like have my vision of the world be uninfluenced.
Which is so funny because some people are doing the exact opposite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which is interesting.
With intent.
The reason I wanted to bring this up is because these are like, you know, 20-hour audiobooks. Yeah, these are not short books.
They are thick.
And I've basically binged the series. Not like all in a week, but basically like listening to Audible, I've just been listening to these books back to back to back to back to back. So this is like, I've basically spent about 140 hours with this series, and that's been like all of my audiobook listening for the past few months. And so it's funny, some of the things I start to notice where I start getting a little bit picky in weird ways. And I think this is like the, basically the idea behind this other stuff is the dangers of binging a book series, because there's very little to criticize about this series. I think it's extremely well written. It's a really cool hard sci-fi setting. They seem to have really done their research, and even if they didn't, they can kind of convince you they did.
That's true, actually.
And like, I start to notice things like little tics that the writers have, tendencies that they have, or ways that they describe things that, like, not in like in any serious way, like it doesn't actually annoy me, but like, I'll kind of be like, oh, they use that, they overuse that metaphor, for example,
that phrase.
Or the way that they describe something, whatever the case might be. Or even, and actually their story structure is really good. Their plotting is excellent. Mm-hmm. But sometimes like there's like a little bit of predictability toward like, oh yeah, here's what's going to happen about this point in the story, mm-hmm. that sort of thing.
My favorite phrase is by an order of magnitude.
Right. Yeah. Things like that. Or familiar is an old song.
Yeah.
That was a good one. So like we could probably keep naming these off, but we're not going to right now.
If you can't tell, I've binged these as well.
Yeah. And so, it's just kind of funny how I think that you can get a little bit spoiled to how good the books actually are if you listen to them too close together. Because you start picking apart these little things when actually, like, these are really excellent books. And I'll go and listen to some other book series or something like that and be like, oh man, this isn't as well written as it could have been, that sort of thing. And so I almost feel like having them spaced out is kind of like you get your treat every year or so of like, yes, I get to look forward to this book and I get to enjoy something really awesome, instead of possibly underappreciating something because it just happened to be like, oh yeah, this book wasn't as strong as like the two around it, even though mm-hmm. in the context of my year of reading, it might've been the best book I read all year.
That's a really great point. I mean, number five was my favorite just because it starred all the, one of the things they do is they put a given chapter from the perspective mm-hmm. of one character, and right. then that shifts. And so number five is all the crew of the Rosinante. Mm-hmm. And that's like the one book where they did that. Mm-hmm. And I really loved having Alex's perspective for that one book and, mm-hmm. and that kind of a thing. We keep saying they, maybe we should explain who they mm-hmm. is, because the Expanse is the name of the TV series and it's sort of the nickname for the book series. But one of the reasons why they're 19 hour audiobooks and many hundreds and hundreds of pages is because there's two authors. Mm-hmm. And specifically, their names are Daniel Abraham and Ty Frank, but they write under the pseudonym of James S.A. Corey. Mm-hmm. And so they pick a character and will trade off writing that character from that perspective. And so one of the things I love about it is even though their writing styles match very closely, mm-hmm. there are slight differences like you were talking about where you really feel like you're getting a different kind of character perspective. One of the two guys, and I don't know which of them, he likes profanity a lot more than the other. And I find that interesting.
So you probably wrote Avasarla, I'm guessing.
Would not surprise me a bit. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. But then the other one will say, and he swore.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wait, the last chapter you were dropping bombs, man.
Right, right.
But so little things like that, I'm with you. But I'm willing to be very forgiving on that because of the two working together to crank out a novel a year. And that's so cool. Mm-hmm. That's so cool. But no, you make a super important point, I think, which is, you know, can we ruin a thing by binging it? Mm-hmm. Especially since I assume being audiobooks, you were doing something else at the same time.
Very often, yes.
I mean, you weren't just sitting on your couch listening to the audiobook.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Driving or working out, usually.
Yeah, for me, you know, washing dishes and, mm-hmm. and doing yeah. housework. And mm-hmm.
I got an Echo for Christmas, and so I would play it while I was cooking or cleaning or
nice.
Something like that. Yeah.
Nice. I use, in the car, I listen mm-hmm. to it a lot. But, that's a very different experience than sitting in a hammock and reading a book.
Right. Ain't nobody got time for that. Well, some people do.
Hey, I do. I used to. I have a 3-year-old now, so.
Just for the record, though, binging these books did not by any means ruin them. I think actually this might have been one of the few series that could withstand that.
Oh, I agree.
Even someone like, you know, Brandon Sanderson, who I really respect as an author, and he's a really great fantasy author. I can't listen to too much of his stuff at once because of all those same sort of things, you start to notice the ticks, the patterns, and as good as this stuff is, I think that you definitely need to sort of take him in chunks and then have a break.
Hmm.
Otherwise, it can get kind of tiring. Whereas this one actually kept me engaged through all 140 hours of the series.
Amazing.
So, yeah.
Amazing. Well, maybe that's the mark of a really good series. Mm-hmm. Something like the Harry Potter series where you're like, I just finished the book. I want the next one. And it's fun to go into a series that is acclaimed and know you've got 6 or 7 books that you can mm-hmm. really dig into, instead of read that first one and be like, wow, that's amazing, I need to wait 17 years before the author dies and we never get the last one.
Yep.
Robert Jordan looking at you.
It's time for Game Show, where the Backward Compatible crew play a game show kind of game on their gaming show. What sort of crazy game show challenges in store this week on Game Show? Let's find out right now on Game Show.
Okay, so it's time for a game show, and we're going to bring back Elevator Pitch, which I think was very successful last time we played, which I believe was on our end of year show.
Yeah, the holiday special.
Holiday special, yes, thank you. We were celebrating Life Day, I think, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So we're going to tweak the rules a little bit. And last time we had teams, and we had two people teamed up, worked together to pitch a game, and the game, all they had to go on was the name. And we used the video game name generator off of, let's see, actually it is called specifically the video game name generator, but it's on videogamena.me if you want to check it out for yourself. And it generates
That's so clever.
Yes, very strange names. And we had a lot of fun playing it. And this time I want to play again. We're going to put a couple of slight tweaks on the rules. So whoever, we're going to essentially be on individual teams, just ourselves. And, because this is a twist, I'm going to go ahead and we're just going to play a couple of rounds just to see how it goes. And we'll bring it back for a longer session if it goes over really well. So I'm going to sit this round out, or this particular game out, and I'll go ahead and just kind of be the impartial judge this time.
Impartial.
What I'd love to do is, if we have guests come in, I'd love for them to be the impartial judge. Would be really nice. Or have one of us sit out and let the guests play, and we could be an impartial
judge. Spot. Yeah.
It could be really fun, but for now, there's only three of us. So we're going to try this way. And what we'll do is the team is just... Doc is by himself and Chris is by himself. But the way that it will work is I will give one of you the name and you're going to start talking, and the other person is going to be able to jump in whenever they want. And the goal is for them to trip you up. Right. So, Doc, if it's your turn and you have a game and you're pitching that game to me, mm-hmm. just like before, anything that you say, that's gospel. That happens. Right. He can't just say, no, that didn't happen. But he can say, yes, and. That's part of the game. Yes, and this happens. So you have to build off what he says. And his goal is to trip you up so that you stumble and can't pitch the game well enough, and so you get a lower score. And that's the incentive to do it, because you're competing against one another, even though you'll be working together both rounds, right?
Hmm. Wow.
Yeah. So it's a little twist, a little more sinister this time around.
Which is great, because I'm excellent to being competitive. No, I'm not.
Yeah.
So let me give you your name, Chris. I will let you see it, and you'll have just a few seconds that I have to switch over to my timer to prepare, and that's it. You have 90 seconds. The title of your game is Regal Baking Explorer. Go.
So, of course, this is about a rich foodie who his hobby basically is to travel the world and to try various baked goods. And so he's sort of a connoisseur.
What about the secret levels?
The secret levels, of course, have to do with the really rare things that are hard to find. And so you're going to be traveling the world and trying to find the bakeries that are the... kind of like the holes in the wall that nobody knows about, but yet make the best stuff.
Oh, that's where the sewer comes in.
Yes. So you go underground into the sewer, and there are various rats in the establishment. So like part of the exploration is like avoiding infection from rats and that sort of thing.
And the rat king.
Yes, the rat king.
Because it's regal.
Yes. No, you're the regal one, but it's kind of like a rat king versus your regalness. And so there's actually kind of like a... The Rat King's actually metaphorical for your rival. He is kind of trying to dethrone you in a sense. And so as you're going around exploring, there's all these hazards that you have to overcome. And so it's almost evocative of kind of like those like 30s pulp kind of adventure exploration. You're traveling the world and you're kind of being hounded by some villains led by the Rat King on your quest to find the best bakeries throughout the world.
And why the choice not to release on PC?
Because we felt that the console market was a little bit more in line with this. So, you know, things like Uncharted are very well known as console games. And so we just felt like it was the console market lent itself well to this exploration and adventure.
Time. Wow. Okay. Regal Baking Explorer. That was Regal Baking Explorer. Interesting take there from Doc, going with the questions, question and answer, just making him think. It was good. It's a good game. I would probably not play this game. I'll say that much. If I had to put a score on that game, wow, that's a tough one. Whew. I think I'd go as high as 7. Right. I thought it was a successful pitch. I will say that Doc did trip you up one time there. Mm-hmm. So I did automatically deduct a point from what I
heard
was thinking.
Him say no.
He did, yes. And that's a point deduction right there. Yes. But good attempt. Good attempt. Definitely. I felt like I kind of recovered
from the no.
You did.
Too.
No, you recovered.
It was like a half agreement.
Yes.
It was,
yeah. Anyway. I think you caught yourself and then you kind of tried to recover from it.
Anyway.
That was good. Okay. So I will read off the title just like I did before, and then we'll start. Chris, you can interrupt at any time as long as it's at the end of like a thought, basically, okay. Like an end of a phrase or something. Okay. So the name of your game, Doc, is My Little Unicycle Bandits. Go.
Okay. So you can imagine animals all on little unicycles. It's adorable. It's endearing. We love it. But what happens whenever those animals have their unicycles stolen by bandits? This is what takes us into the magical world of My Little Unicycle Bandits.
Now, the physics engine, though, sounds like you don't have very good physics or game feel for the unicycles.
Not necessary, because what we have is a 2.5D expression within the context of a neo-retro feel. It's a bit like taking the modern graphics and superimposing them upon an old idea, which is brand new.
So tell me about the competitive multiplayer, though.
Okay, so the competitive multiplayer is actually kind of a side mission. The DLC levels, which we're going to be including for an additional very, very reasonable price of $1 to $2, is so that we can have bicycle jumps with the animals and they can try to get distance. It's nothing about, you know, blood or killing. We don't want any of that in Unicycle Bandit.
Now, explain to me how you're justifying the loot box system that you've built into this.
Well, the loot box is completely...
dang it.
Cosmetic is the word I'm looking for. It's completely cosmetic. It affects gameplay in no way at all.
Wow.
Dadgum, I was so close.
Loot box has nailed you on that one.
Wow. Well done. Well done.
Oh, that was a good run though. Honestly, I'd have to give that one the same score as 7. But because Chris did have the one faux pas of the game, I'm gonna have to give the winner to be Doc.
Woo!
Fair.
But that was good. You really tricked him up on that last part. he was doing great right until the end.
My unicycle was headed straight for that ramp and then I crashed.
Yeah. I was impressed until that moment, and then you completely tricked him up. That was a good one.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
A little bit early in our back talk segment, we talked about the idea that gamers don't know what they want. And of course, there's a little bit more to that. We talked at length about that specific circumstance and the paraphrase that came out of it. But we kind of had this interesting thought of like the idea that developers don't know what they want. And Jim, I think you were mentioning too, maybe you could explain a little better than I can. basically the idea that we have a lot of developers who are kind of wanting to make a movie, it feels like, more so than make a game. Or maybe,
right,
maybe they have a hard time striking that balance between wanting to tell a specific story versus making a game. And do you want to talk about that?
Right, and this was something Doc and I had talked about right early on before the show started. And it's this idea that we've been noticing more and more. It's honestly been a problem in the game industry for probably 20 years, if we're being honest with ourselves. But it's cropped up more and more as graphics have gotten better and better. And they're games where really it feels like the person behind the game, the person that's making the game, is more interested in providing the user with what they call a cinematic experience. And whenever I hear that phrase, I kind of cringe, because my expectation is, really, they want it to feel like you're playing a movie.
Cutscenes.
Yeah, and cutscenes can work. Cutscenes can be good.
Sure, I mean,
cutscenes can enhance a gaming experience as long as it's a game. And then the cutscene is helping to tell the story of that game.
I think a lot of people tend to complain more about QuickTime events.
And that's what I'm really talking about, is where you're not so much in control of your character. You're not in control of what's going on. You're not controlling the game. You're not controlling the story. You're just sort of railroaded to have this experience that the developer wants you to have.
Press X not to die.
Yeah. So they're really what they wanted to do is make a movie, and they weren't able to get the budget and the funding to make that movie. So instead they made a game, which is essentially just presented as though it were a linear story. And games, you know, as we know, games are not linear. Even if the story of the game is linear, the experience shouldn't be, because you as the player are able to control. Even in, say, Super Mario Bros., you're able to control what you do. Well, not in some games today, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I think that might have been your concern on last week's show about Spider-Man, that they might be doing the same thing. At least that's something that concerns me about that, to use an example of a game that is not out yet.
Yeah, if you missed that episode, I mentioned Mysterio as being my favorite character from the Spider-Man 2 game, which was on GameCube, and in my opinion, one of the best open world games ever. I feel like I've been to New York City. I never have, except the airport, but I know the layout of New York because of the many, many hours I logged on that game, gosh, 15, 20 years ago. Mm. So yeah, to me, if Mysterio had been a part of that movie, Spider-Man 2, you know, the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man, that wouldn't have worked. It just wouldn't have worked. And so to me, it was a valuable Spider-Man experience and a more rich Spider-Man experience in that game, because that story was told in that way, richly within the context of a bunch of, I don't even want to call them side quests, but that's what they were.
Right. And what we saw from the trailer of Spider-Man, just pick on that game a little more.
Mm-hmm. You mean the new one?
Yes, the new one, the trailer for the new PS4 Spider-Man. What we saw in that game was what felt, they were very, it was basically a trailer of Spider-Man trying to defeat one of these villains. He has to sneak up on him, and it kind of has this Arkham Asylum, you know, stealthish element to it initially.
Yeah, you're right.
But then there was this big scene where you break in, you're trying to stop the guy, and there's this big, I think it was a trailer or something attached to a helicopter, and it's like busting its way through a city. And the way that Peter interacts with it, it very much feels like a series of QuickTime events.
Yeah.
And so I think really that's kind of what we're talking about here mostly, are when you're putting either QuickTime events into your game, or you're railroading the player experience in order to make sure that they're playing the game the way you think they should play it.
Oh, that's well said.
Right?
That's a terrible thing, but it's well said.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think that maybe the solution to this, or the dividing line, the razor's edge, if you will, to know whether or not this is a story or that should be a movie or not, is what I've always said as a guideline whenever I'm teaching game design. And that's, if it's not interactive, make a movie or write a book. Would you agree with that?
I mean, I would. I think that's the key for games, is they are interactive. However, there is that element of, okay, just how much interaction does it take before, and is there still value there too? Because we have talked some, at least I know I have, criticized certain experiences that I say, and criticize is the wrong word. I've commented on some games that I will say, games in quotation marks, that I will say are not really games. It's more of an interactive experience, or, you know, maybe it's an interactive narrative, but it's not really a game per se. That's not necessarily a bad thing either. So I think there's a recognition, like a lot of the Telltale games, to use the term loosely again, I feel they are more interactive stories that you're running through.
I won't disagree with
that. And you have choices along the way. A lot of them are actually false choices, but you have choices along the way, and but you're essentially still experiencing a story, you know, and that you have a few choices, but it's a mostly linear story that occasionally you can determine, okay, either this person dies or that person dies. But otherwise, whoever survives, they're still going to, they're either going to get killed or they're going to disappear from your group no matter what. I mean, they did this from the very start with Walking Dead.
Mm-hmm. And also, yeah. I think like some of the earlier Telltale games of that format had arguably more of like a game-like feel because they borrowed a lot of elements. Like The Walking Dead did this, for example, of old adventure games, point-and-click adventure games, where you have to like get this item and use it here in order to proceed. So like there's a little bit of a puzzle element or sometimes like little segments of like some gameplay, quote-unquote, that's not just quick-time events. It's things like there's like a little shooter segment, for example, in The Walking Dead.
Those were few and far between, to be fair.
And they've sort of moved away from that, too, I think.
Right, they have.
It's become a lot more just kind of like choose your dialogue option, have a quick time event, that sort of thing. And, you know, I think that I basically agree that if we want to sort of differentiate between, say, interactive fiction or interactive narrative versus a game, there are definitely ways we can do that. I'm still a proponent of kind of like having a broader definition of game. I'm comfortable with calling a lot of stuff that you wouldn't call a game, technically speaking, calling it a game just because of the packaging and the format in which it's delivered.
So, but part of that, too.
But as casual use of the term.
I mean, what I don't understand when I hear some of that criticism is, why is that a bad thing? Just because you say, hey, that's not a game, that's not a, like, there's this up in arms approach that some people take. And what do you mean that's not a game?
Yeah.
It's not a defensive thing to say. Mm-hmm. Some things are games and some things aren't. It's just this is a car, this is not a car. It's not the car is not a good value. There's plenty of games that are
but they're
horrible.
Both vehicles.
Yeah, like car or motorcycle or something. Yeah, right.
I mean, part of it is the terminology.
Yeah,
I mean, sure. It's like, okay, if we've got an interactive media thing that's not a game, well, what is it? We don't have a good term for that.
And without breaking down like too much the history around this, a lot of this comes out of like weird cultural stuff, like around Gamergate and stuff like that. Yeah. People kind of being divisive over what gaming culture is.
It comes out of things that straight up are not games. I mean, it goes back to our topic. Developers don't know what they want, right? So it comes out of things like they're making I've heard this is another term that's thrown around a lot that doesn't have as much meaning anymore, but walking simulator. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you've heard this term.
Yes.
And that's referring to, and some games you could argue are a walking simulator. Others are not really. It's just, it's become a negative term because it is a negative thing to say. But the concept here is that if all you're doing is you're in a space and you're exploring a space, but there's no win-lose condition.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really a game. And there are, quote, games. They're marketed as games that are really either they're an environmental story, like they're just explore an environment, or they're an interactive narrative, and they're not really a game. And I think that, you know, there is such a thing as this is a game and this is not a game. And I think it's something that we can, you know, agree to and figure out. But if you're trying to make, if you want to make a environment in which you explore and have an experience and learn something about a character, that's fine. Do that. And there is a space for those things too. There's also a space for interactive art, right? And this is something that you see, you know, caught on for a little while, and I'm not sure if it's still considered as fresh as maybe it was, you know, 15 years ago or so, but this is still something that, you know, still does exist, and still there's still interactive art pieces out there and interactive art exhibits, I should say. And there's nothing wrong with doing something like that. But to get back to what we were talking about really with a developer, because if a developer is making an interactive art, well, they know what they're doing, right? They're making interactive art. So regardless of whether, you know, Chris wants to say, oh, I still want to call that a game or not, it doesn't matter what you call it, right? It is, that's what the developer wanted to make, and that's what they made. So my issue isn't with developers that make something that, you know, is meant to be interactive art or is meant to be an interactive story, and someone plays it and says, well, that's not a game because I was expecting more of a game. Well, it wasn't really meant to be a game in the first place. That's fine. Make what you need to make. The problem is when a developer makes a game that they are saying is a game and pretending is a game, and they're expecting people to play it as a game, but in actuality, it's really a movie that they wanted to make, right? Or it's a, you know, a novel or a television series that they wanted to make.
All right, so let me see if I can throw a wrench into your works here. 2017 BlizzCon, Jeff Kaplan talks about how the Overwatch team originally considered making a multi-class MMO called Crossworlds.
Yes.
And it ended up, even after they'd made all this backstory and all these assets and all these deep, rich characters, being a series of what I will call short films that lead to a, it's a PvP shooter. And now they've gotten to a point where they have, what are they called? The championships?
The Overwatch League?
Yeah, the Overwatch League, right? You say what you will, it's certainly not the original vision. Did they fail? Or did they wildly succeed? Did they make a wonderful, delicious decision? Or did they cop out?
I think they figured out what it was turning into and then decided to focus on that.
They had to discard a lot of assets and backstory and information to do that.
After Crossworlds, there's some other game they're working on called Titan, and maybe like the two ideas are kind of merged into what became Overwatch. I'd have to go back and check the history again, but yeah, no, there were a lot of things they were kind of working on and then ditched and changed until they got to the final product.
I mean, that's part of design, right? That's part of development.
Iteration and experimentation.
Yes.
And
yes. Is that because they didn't know what they wanted?
I think sometimes they may know what they want in a general sense, but you're not going to necessarily know the specifics until you start exploring it. Mm-hmm. And especially when you have a full team, it depends on how your team is set up, right? So some games you might have, this is the vision of, you know, this one or two people. But other teams, it could be, you don't really have that strong vision, right? You just have, this is, you're tasked with making a certain sort of game, or you decide you're going to make a certain sort of game, or someone tells you we need you to make this type of game. And as a team, through an iterative process, you determine what that game is.
Okay. I like that word. I was actually going to ask you, are you suggesting an iterative process, which is interesting. I look at it this way. Pixar, the last good movie they made, Inside Out.
Which wasn't that long ago.
No, it really wasn't.
Coco was good. Did you see Coco?
No, actually, I haven't seen Coco.
Coco was excellent.
I need to see Coco. One of the amazing things about that film is the special features about how they made that film. And it was a five-year process of a vague sort of messy kind of idea-ish thing they wanted to do. And then there were dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of sort of rewrites, post-its on walls. The visuals are amazing on the sort of the scratch work that they did in this. And so Disney's basically funding this, these guys to just sit around and come up with this idea for this thing that isn't going anywhere until it does. Do you see what I'm saying? And that's an iterative process. And that's pretty easy to do whenever it's a linear thing like a movie that has themes and characters and that sort of a thing.
But I think you can do that with a game, depending on the sort of game. So like, especially...
You anticipated my question. Right. That's exactly what I was going
to
ask.
Especially if it's... You're trying to come up with the lore for a new game and like the background and the characters and the world that they're in. Like what is the mythos of this universe, right? So there's a lot of that. That takes a lot of time to work through and typically there isn't just one person that comes up with it unless it's based on some other work, right? It's usually lots of people working together. Like you look at the lore of, you know, say Elder Scrolls, for example, one person didn't come up with that. No. Lots of people worked on it.
Right.
And sometimes the reverse happens. I like to use the example of Splatoon, where Nintendo is wanting to make a game where you like were basically painting the ground. And basically I forget exactly the series of events was that led to this, but essentially,
an apocalypse. Actually,
they did
it's a dystopian apocalypse wherein mutations occur and everyone becomes the squid people.
Not quite.
Oh, the squid people become the people.
But they were looking at mechanics first, and then when they were trying to figure out what sort of character kind of fits these mechanics, they figured a squid fit that mechanic. And so from there, they were able to build out the world and the aesthetic and all that different stuff.
Do you think? And that's something I'm glad you touched on that, because I think this is just my. This is my speculation. I don't know if this is true, but I feel that great games, if you're trying to make an actual game, and again, I'm making a distinction for interactive narrative, an interactive environment, interactive art, and then a game, something different, right? If you're going to make a great game, because games live and die by their mechanics, by the gameplay. So that's where you have to start. You may not know exactly what you're doing, but that's the starting point. And then everything else has to grow out of that.
I think you can also...
Let me put it this way. Mm-hmm. Let's say for Super Mario Brothers, the mm-hmm. original Super Mario Brothers, when you know, Miyamoto and the team at Nintendo were going to make that game, and it was supposed to be, and it was meant to be, a way to showcase the power of the Famicom, which later known in the U.S. as the Nintendo Entertainment System. They wanted to showcase what it could do, because a lot of developers at the time didn't understand, and of course it was only in Japan because it wasn't even out in America yet, and this was in 1985. So the Famicom came out in 1983. In 1985, developers still were making games that were either ports from the arcade or were similar to arcade games in terms of style.
That's a good point.
They didn't really know how to use the power of the Nintendo Entertainment System. And so I can't remember his name, but the original owner, director of Nintendo, tasked his team, which includes Miyamoto, with coming up with a game that could show off what the NES could do. And that included things that were, you know, revolutionary for their time, like the you're on a screen, and as you go from left to right, the screen moves along with you, and you have this like long world that kind of continuous space, right, for mm-hmm. a level, along with various other things like the jumping mechanics, etc. So those gameplay elements, that's what determined the game. And then from there, like what the game was, mm-hmm. and then from there, all the little extra stuff, like you're in the Mushroom Kingdom, and you're there's the Goombas, and you have the power to jump, and you can jump, and you can squash a Goomba by jumping on his head. And if you jump on a Koopa Troopa, all they do is they go back into their shell, and then you can kick that shell, right? So things like that, you know, the characters grew out of those mechanics. Mm-hmm. And of course, some of it was based on existing earlier games like Mario Bros. Or Donkey Kong, yes, because they reuse some of those characters. But my point is that the mechanics, the characters grew out of the mechanics. Another mm-hmm. great example, Donkey Kong, the original Donkey Kong, was originally meant to be a Popeye game.
Yeah.
They were going to use the characters. Miyamoto was tasked with, he had an idea for a game, and he was like, he wanted to use the Popeye characters for this game. And it was going to be, Bluto was Donkey Kong, and Popeye was Mario, and Olive Oil was Pauline, the female character. And when they were told they couldn't use those characters, the game didn't really change. Mm-hmm. The characters changed, but the game didn't actually really change.
It sounds to me like whenever you're pitching an idea for a game or formulating an idea for a game, you're saying we should start with mechanics first.
I'm saying you should start. Yes. I mean, not even necessarily the all the nitty gritty mechanics, but yeah, you need to understand when it's okay. Do you know what you want? Well, you have to understand, okay, I'm making an arcade platformer. And if that's what you're making, and then go from there and try to expand from there.
Interesting.
I think the other way you can arrive at that, though, and I think that the mechanics first approach is definitely valid, and we've seen it work many times. I think, though, you can also go into it saying, I want to make a game about blank. And this is especially true, I think, in board games, maybe even more so than video games, where like I want to somehow capture this aspect of, say, farming culture, agricola, or something like
that.
Yeah,
whatever.
And then from that, you figure out like, what is it that I want the game to say, or what do I want players to do in this game, and then build the mechanics up around mm-hmm. that.
No, I think that's valid too. I think what we're talking about is either, you know, kind of a mechanics approach, or maybe like a genre or a theme approach, mm-hmm. right?
Well, but genre. When in you sense say of genre, games, what do you mean?
I want
gameplay.
I'm glad you asked. Yes, I mean gameplay. I mean,
okay.
When we talk about games, you know, genre. It's like you have to know you're making a platformer, for example. If you're mm-hmm. making Super Mario Brothers. You can't go, I'm going to make this story about the Mushroom Kingdom, and it could be an FPS, it could be an adventure game, it could be a role-playing game, or it could be a platformer. You got to narrow it down in scope before that into, okay, what sort of genre am I making? Game genre.
Sure.
Right? And I think some of the problems that we get into with developers not knowing what they want, really, is they might start with a genre, but they might start with a film genre / film or movie or yes. television genre, where like they go, okay, I want to make this science fiction game, right? Well, okay, but what's the genre? It's science fiction, but that you're not answering the question from a game perspective, right?
Right.
Is it an action? It's an action game. Is it a role-playing game? Is it a adventure or like, you know, like an interactive narrative sort of game, or is it a platformer? Is it a shoot 'em up? Right? As a shooter. So there's so many things. If you say science fiction, you could be talking about Doom, or you could be talking about Gradius. These are completely different games. They're both science fiction.
Okay, so let me throw a wrench into your works.
Sure.
You've got Fallout. Pick your Fallout.
Right.
Okay, Fallout. Let's go with Fallout 3. Fallout 3, okay, and you've got Skyrim. They're very similar games, built in the same engine.
Fallout 3 and Oblivion were, but yeah.
Yeah, okay. The mechanics are essentially the same, right? And there's some differences, like the VAT system and that sort of thing. But ultimately, what you're talking about is an action RPG set in a dynamically rich world. One is sci-fi, one is fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
That is a major problem, though, if you're going to compare those two games, because those are two very, very different games, even though the mechanics are similar.
See, I would argue that they're actually not very different games. I think that's the flaw of the design of Fallout 3, is that you just pointed right at it. The flaw is that they took Oblivion and they said, well, it works in Oblivion. Let's make, we've just bought the Fallout property. Let's make Fallout using the same, you know, the same sort of design principles that we used for Oblivion, mm-hmm. and the same sort of mechanics that we used for Oblivion. We'll add guns, and oh yeah, let's include VATs, because that was kind of cool. But that was it. I mean, that I think was the biggest flaw of Fallout 3.
So they just bought,
in my opinion,
they just bought the property of Fallout 3. What should they have done? What would have been the correct starting point?
The correct starting point?
Yeah.
So
for them, in their case,
right,
they're going to make Fallout 3.
They did need to make a decision of, you know, what are the mechanics going to be? And they, at that point, had already sort of decided they're not going, because they knew it was going to be an RPG, but they weren't going to go with the old isometric style, right, because that was something that was just not as popular.
Yeah, the three-quarter view.
So they wanted to go for the, you know, 3D, either over the shoulder or first person. So I understand those decisions.
Mm-hmm.
But what they should have done was they should have looked at why they bought the Fallout property and what was there and what defines Fallout. And once you figure that out, then that determines, you know, the mechanics of the game.
So you
and
don't think they did that?
No, I think Obsidian did that with Fallout New Vegas.
I think they did that and failed, but
I think they tried to do that, but they looked at the wrong things. What they did was they saw, what makes Fallout? There's sometimes some quirky humor about the 1950s and retro stuff, and there's that line from War Never Changes, and it's a post-apocalypse. Okay, go. And one of the biggest points of the first two Fallout games, and again, this goes back to why I think Bethesda failed with Fallout 3 and Fallout 4, was because they focused too much on the main story. They go, what's our main story? This needs to be the main thrust of the game, and it's going to drive you throughout the game. And then along the way, you might have side quests. But if you remember back to Fallout 1 and 2, you did have a main quest, but your main quest was very vague.
That's true.
It was background. The key was explore the world and find interesting people and side quests. Mm-hmm. That was really what the game was about.
I loved the water chip hook, because it was like, out there somewhere is a water chip.
Yes.
We only know about one town and it's down here. Go.
Yeah.
That's it. And I mean, that's all you get.
And that's another issue that I think part of it that they kind of had missed the mark.
And also you're on a timer.
Yes.
And, you know, the other thing that I think we can talk a little bit about, too, is that at the time the Fallout 3 came out, there was this kind of push in the games industry to have more narrative expression in games, to like be able to tell stronger narratives. And maybe it was misguided. Maybe they didn't do it as well as they thought they did. But the idea at the time was that people wanted to enhance games, quote unquote, sure, by having very meaningful, powerful storytelling. And so they probably looked at this as like, hey, we're going to enhance this game. That might have been too, it might not hook people. We're going to kind of have like this great developer driven story that people are going to enjoy, and then also have the freedom to do other stuff, as opposed to having lots of freedom that happens to have nice stories pocketed throughout.
And the irony here, have you played the first two Fallout games?
No, I've not.
Yeah. So the irony of that is that the first two Fallout games actually did have a strong story.
They had a great story.
So the irony of it was that
emergent story.
Mm-hmm. Emergent story. Exactly. Bethesda saw it as, we need to give this main linear story for the main quest that drives the whole game.
Yeah.
And that's what they thought was good story, when really the good story of the games was actually came out of the environment and came out of the interactions with the people and all, and the NPCs that you run into, and all of the, like, you know, side quests and stories and events that you saw within the game. So it actually had a rich story.
Oh yeah, I'm not saying it didn't.
No, but I'm not trying to, you know, claim, because I know you haven't played it, so I'm not trying to, you know, pick on you for that. It's just, my point is that there was a, and this actually is a great game to examine in this topic, I think, because that concept of, we need to have a strong backbone story for a game, is not correct. But that might be one of the problems. You know, like, developers may not know what they want, or they may not know what the player wants when it comes to, say, a Fallout experience, if their drive is the single player story, like the developer driven story of a main quest. I mean, even the people that loved Fallout 3, and, you know, mostly because they hadn't played the originals, but regardless, the ones who loved Fallout 3, they didn't love it because, oh, I got to go find my dad. No, they loved it because of the world and exploring and the exploration aspect of it. So, you know, but that wasn't what Blizzard, you know, I'm not Blizzard, Bethesda spent so much time focusing on. It was that initial quest that they didn't even have to do that. So I do think that that's something too, where it's like, does a game need that one rich narrative thread? Some games might, based on the way they're designed, but a game, to be a game, you don't need that.
And so I think, you know, kind of coming back to our initial question of, are there times when developers don't know what they want? And we sort of framed this around the idea that, like, you know, if it's not interactive, make a movie, write a book. I think, though, that no game developer ever goes into making a game thinking that they're not making a game. I think that they have at least a general sense that they want to.
I don't know about that.
So let me explain
Quantic
my
dream.
Let me explain my thinking here.
Yeah.
There's always some element of interactivity. They want it to be like this genre or this style of game or whatever the case might be. But they're thinking, generally speaking, that I'm going to make a game. They're not thinking I'm going to make a movie. And so I think that where we start to run into problems is when they might have like a really strong story idea and not a strong game idea. And they don't do enough to make the story serve the game, or vice versa. And when they start to focus too heavily on one or the other, you start to run into problems. And if you have to like favor one, I'd say favor the strong game at the cost, like, you know, let the story serve the game more so than the other way around.
Right.
I think you can also, though, have like the game mechanics really serve your story in powerful ways. But I think that someone might say, I'm going to make an RPG and I want to tell this story, but they might spend too much time thinking about the story and not enough time thinking about, how do I make a fun RPG? So you've got the RPG in there. It just might not be the best conceived RPG, if you know what I'm saying.
You know, you push to the other end too hard and you end up with not a game as well. Classic example is Minecraft before the game over screen with its nonsensical poetry and the end and all of that stuff.
Well, that's a great example of like something that really wasn't a game initially.
Right. And yet, even after it became, quote unquote, a game by shoehorning in all these things that made it into one, it still wasn't one from the perspective of having a story or having a way to beat it.
And, it wasn't designed, you know, from the start as a game. It was designed as a sandbox playground.
Right? And we can debate whether or not the word game is an appropriate designation.
You start getting into semantics there.
Yeah, that's semantic.
I spent way too much time in college having that discussion.
Yeah, so. No kidding, right? but ultimately, what it comes down to, I think, for me is, if you're talking about something that is has both gameplay and also narrative, it has both of those things.
Are you saying that games have to have narrative?
No, I am not. But okay, what I am saying is, if we are specifically talking within the context of something that has both of those ingredients, okay, that I think that there's a case to be made that not only are game makers, let's call them developers, we've been doing that, falling short on understanding how to incorporate their narrative into the gameplay. Okay. Do you get what I mean by I say
yes,
that?
Yes.
But honestly, I would go broader than that. And I would say that I think that narratives at large are misfiring and failing right now due to the shiny graphics. I would look, for example, at the modern Transformer movies. I would look at the Star Wars films. I would look at things like...
you know what? The big budget.
Star Trek.
Big budget pictures, yeah, right?
Anything that has the marble label on it,
I would agree with you completely.
I think that what, you know, I'll out Will Parsons since he can't defend himself. He's been on the show before, but he's called this a series of YouTube clips. That the superhero movies are a series of YouTube clips. And I think that's a wonderful description because it's lots of explosions and a very, very loose plot.
That we have like lots of cool moments we want to have and then we sort of string them together. However,
but it doesn't actually hold up when you look at it a second time, it doesn't make sense and it doesn't hold up. And there's nothing that makes any sense about this. And I think a lot of games suffer from the same thing. Horizon Zero Dawn would be my number one on that list from last year that, there were so many cool things about that game. I loved the fighting of the robot dinosaurs. I thought that was great. I enjoyed the plot. But the two things together really did not mesh. They did not intertwine and they made no sense. It was like taking a piece of leather and trying to tie it to yourself with a shoelace. Mm. It just, those two things, it worked, but only kind of sort of barely.
They also kind of borrowed a lot of elements from like, hey, this is a way that environmental storytelling, quote unquote, worked in this other game. Oh, you can pick up these audio logs and listen to it as you keep exploring.
Yeah.
But to your point, you kind of made this point before we started recording that you almost like, let me stop, play a different game for a while to explore like this little lab or dungeon or whatever.
Correct.
Get the story background stuff and then go back into the world where I'm playing the game as I know it, like where you're hunting.
Yeah. So robots. Criticize Fallout 3 all you want. I never felt that way. Never, ever did I feel that way. And Fallout 4, the same kind of a thing.
I think we're identifying a couple of different problems, right? I
mean, yes, we are.
There's not just one problem that happens in some modern games. Mm-hmm. There's multiple problems.
There are. And so I would say that, to use gun metaphors, since both of these are about shooting things, you've got the shotgun shell scatter fire that is a Fallout game of what do I do because there's just too much, I've lost the plot, versus this sort of arrow being shot into the dark, which is Horizon Zero Dawn, if you catch my meaning there, in terms of the plot.
Sure.
Specifically the plot, not gameplay, but plots, those were metaphors. And so I guess what I would ask then is, how do you pitch then a story, a narrative? What is the right format for a narrative for a video game that's going to have X number of hours? And this is where you start getting into models. In my opinion, this is the solution. That whenever we say this game is like a movie, that's so wrong. It's completely wrong. The game is like a TV series, or the game is like a mini series, or the game is like a collection of short stories. We need to start thinking in those frameworks instead.
See, I think, but even there, you could get into a trap where you're trying to, you'd rather be making a TV series than a game. I think what you should start with is, what are you going to do? What do you do? Because that's what makes it a game. What do you do?
That's true.
So start with your verbs. What do you want the player to do? Or how do you want the player to feel as they're doing it? Right. Mm-hmm. So start with, what are they going to do?
A valid assertion.
How do I want them to feel?
Assertion.
Go insert a mint, Jim.
But yeah, no. So coming back to that. So start with what you want the player to do, then go to how you want the player to feel when they do it. And then start adding on, okay, how do I do that? What sort of, do I need a story to do that? And if so, what does that story need to be? And that way you're making sure that whatever story you have is going to, assuming that your game needs to have a story, because clearly some games don't, but those that do, so that your story will complement what the player is doing.
Or to go in the reverse direction, think about what story you're trying to tell and then how you can best complement that with your gameplay. Because I think sometimes people will go into something saying, I want to make a shooter with this sort of story. Well, what if maybe a platformer is actually the better way to convey that story? Something like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So like,
I would cite Overwatch again. Mm-hmm. If the stories, plural, that were being conveyed were actually the stories of the characters, those main characters, those backgrounds, those, because there's such a rich world in Overwatch. It's weird. I've never played a single second of Overwatch. Mm-hmm. I've never played it. Yet I know some of the backstories of those characters. They are that compelling.
And I think that's partially because Overwatch has embraced transmedia.
It has.
So they realize that they can tell stories and storytelling.
Well, and you
formats.
Showed me the movies before the game came out. The shorts.
And they've done that. They were interesting.
I loved them.
Yeah, and I'm sure you've seen some of those little stories and little trailers about the characters and stuff without actually playing the games.
And I think too, like, you know, if you look at the development of Overwatch, they've talked a little bit about how they came up with ideas for different characters. Mm. There's some characters that had a very strong sense of here's this character and here's how we adapt that character into gameplay. Mm. And then there are some times when they actually like started like Farah is a good example, or Farah, where she's the rocket lady. She shoots rockets and she can fly around with their jetpack. They actually came up with the jetpack rocket shooting person idea first. I think they actually called it like jetpack guy or rocket guy at first, right. And then eventually built the character around that. And so in a way, actually, you can kind of argue that she's one of the flatter, less interesting characters, even though they've tried to flesh her out. But that's one of the cases where they started with gameplay and they built the story. But they're also the reverse, where they started with the story of this character and adapted it into the gameplay.
But that was after they already had the core of what the gameplay was, though.
Well, like Doc was saying, right? they started with some other game idea that eventually turned into something else. But I have to check on this. And I think that it's not all like it happened this way and then this way. Mm-hmm. There's probably both happening all the way through.
Part of it was they had the original plan was not even the same game. It was a different sort of game, right? Yeah. That was kind of the idea. Mm-hmm. They were still designing it as a game from the start. Mm-hmm. It wasn't, let's make this whole story and then try to like shoehorn a game into
it. Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Blizzard, I think, is a good example of like balancing all of that. So, you know, maybe this isn't the fairest example, you know, but yeah, there are like better and worse examples of, you know, either shoehorning gameplay into a story or tacking a story onto gameplay.
Well, let me give you another one. And we could argue, because I literally do not know the background of this. So we could argue it either way. Thimbleweed Park. Okay, it feels like one of the old classic adventure games, sort of a LucasArts style game.
Right.
But it's got a lot of modern, let's call it updates to that.
Ron Gilbert worked on that, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So there's basically, and I could probably dig a little bit and find this out, but I'm coming up with this off the top of my head. There's probably two ways that this came about. Either somebody said, you know what, I would love to do an adventure game in the old style as some kind of, I don't know, X-Files thing. Or it was, I have this really cool idea that I want to do as a story. Hey, you know what would be neat is if we actually did it as one of these retro style. Would that work? You know what I'm saying? So either the story came first as a loose idea, or the idea of doing a retro game came first. And I don't know which it was, but it didn't matter because it was a perfect fit for that story in that game in that space. And I think that's really what we're talking about here. We can argue about which one comes first.
And I think the answer is it doesn't matter which one comes first.
As long as it's married well.
Right.
Like Will was this weekend.
Congratulations, Will. I do disagree. And Sarah. I think you make a good point, but I do disagree. I do think it does matter what comes first. And I think it has to be the do. It's got to be the verb. That has to come first.
And I don't think so. I think as long as the do matches with the...
But I think even with like your examples of RPGs that are trying to tell a certain story, I know you talk about like, you know, Japanese RPGs are trying to tell a certain story. They still start at their core. We're making an RPG. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, okay, what's the story? Mm-hmm. They still
have
that core.
But that's only one approach.
But I don't think there is the unless they go the wrong direction with it, of just, I'm going to come up with a story. Okay, now how am I going to make it a game?
Well, it's not necessarily a story as in a narrative. It could be a setting. You know, some of the best pitches that I have ever heard have been pitches that were based on an idea of, okay, we're going to make a game about Roanoke. I still want this game, by the way. I still remember the pitch from when it was pitched in my class. I want to make a game about Roanoke. And it was like, okay, well, what's the gameplay? Well, this is where it gets weird. It's from the perspective of the animals. What? You know, and so I could see it going a lot of different ways. You if you're willing to be flexible, and I really think that's what it comes down to. As developers, I think you've got to be willing to murder your darlings and come in it and go, you know what? Our story idea is solid, but we need a completely different gameplay here. Or our gameplay is amazing, but we need to just scrap that story we had.
And so coming back to our original question, developers don't know what they want. Maybe the problem is they do know what they want and they're not willing to budge on that.
Oh, what a wonderful insight.
Well, and I think that's a good insight too. And I also think that part of our problem too is that we're talking about developers not knowing what they want. Well,
you mean they think they know what they want, but they don't really.
Right.
Full circle.
They think they do, but they don't. Or the problem is that, you know, typically, given the size of games nowadays, there's not just one person. There's not just one vision.
Of course.
It's multiple people. So
of course.
One of them might say, oh, I have a pretty good idea of what we're doing, right? And the other person might think that they have their simpatico with the other person, but they're really not. They really have a different take on what you're actually working on. Mm-hmm. So you have these competing visions, and you start throwing in, you know, 10, 15, 20 people teams, and that's going to be a problem unless you have some sort of a binding force. And like, what is our real goal here? If everybody is not working towards the same goal, then yeah, you're going to have that problem. And then we didn't even touch on developers. I mean, are not always in control of that either.
That's very true. You know, yeah. you've got producers, executive producers,
and the producer could come to you and say, look, we just bought this, cool property called Fallout, and we want you to make a game, within this property.
Yeah.
Okay, what's the game going to be? Oh yeah, so we hear it's really cool now to have these open world first person games, so it needs to be one of those.
Yeah.
Other than that, go ahead. Well, okay, but now you've already sort of boxed them into a certain space that maybe they didn't even want to be in that space in the first place, or maybe they don't understand what that property is, and they certainly weren't told that either. So there is that element of it too, like what's marketable and stuff like that. And the farther away you get from the one or two or three people working on it, that very laser focused vision, and the farther you get away from that to make these larger big budget games, mm-hmm. the bigger the risk of losing focus.
Yeah. Well, and to take up for the producers just a little bit, they are taking all the risk, 80% or so of the risk. So it makes sense that they also get 80% or so of the profits. They're not getting paid up front.
I'm not talking about profits or any of that.
Oh, I know you're not.
Yeah, all I mean is that element of they may be directing is the wrong term, but they may be saying, here's what you're going to make, right?
Right.
And that may not be the best fit for mm-hmm. what they're given.
But what I was going to say is that the opposite is also true. I'll pick on Ken Levine because he's, uber famous. This is exactly what happened with Bioshock 2. Everybody was like, Bioshock was so amazing, give us a 2. And he gives the pitch, and it's okay, the little girls in the first game, now they're all grown up, and oh, we don't have big daddies, we have big sisters. And that was literally the pitch. It was, okay, we're going to start making this game. He had not thought it past that point. And then he left the project, mm-hmm. and then they had nothing. And so I've heard him talk, and he has admitted that one of his notorious problems is that he doesn't actually write the thing until like the 0 hour of the deadline. And like all the assets are created, the levels are created, because he has all these ideas and he can pitch those. But then what he does is he sort of takes everything that he's given and vision cast, and he writes the story is sort of in that last moment, which worked for him for Bioshock and arguably worked for Infinity, or what was it? Infinite, kind of. He told the story he was meaning to tell, but for the second one, you had what was supposed to be one big fight at the end up being a series of repeating fights because they didn't know what to do. So they just kept repeating the big sister fight.
Strangely, I mean, I enjoyed Bioshock 2 more than
A lot Infinite. Of people did. I enjoyed the DLC for that one especially.
I honestly thought Infinite was a complete failure, personally.
I loved the visuals in Infinite, but I thought the story was very, very weak. Yeah. That said, all I'm saying is that the opposite is entirely true. I'm not disagreeing with you mm-hmm. at all. I think that you can have a producer fail, but you can also have a, let's call it creative director fail, and anything in between. Literally, you can have a bad team. You can have,
sure.
personnel problems. You can have vision problems.
One of the worst too is time, right?
Oh, goodness.
Like you could have a great idea. You could start executing it well. And then if you just run out of time, well, suddenly you have to complete the game within, by a certain deadline, you have to start cutting corners. You have to start chopping out content. And sometimes mm-hmm. what you chop out was crucial to make the game work.
Mm-hmm. And you and I will probably never agree on whether or not No Man's Sky suffered from that or suffered from a lack of vision.
I think what it suffered from was they really just had an idea that they thought would be a great way to sell the game, a pitch mm-hmm. essentially, but they didn't actually have a game idea. They didn't have a fully fleshed out idea.
And I think the opposite is true.
They didn't really know what they were doing.
I think they had a fully fleshed out idea that was an overreach to the point where they realized that there was no way they could possibly do it.
And so they worked on the MVP.
Yeah.
And I've seen that. The V wasn't quite so V.
Uh-huh. I've seen that, especially in student projects, where it's like, I'm going to do this thing and it's going to be amazing and I'm going to simulate a real human. And it's like, whoa, bring that back down. And they didn't have, because we're in the Kickstarter era, right? Where it's like, you're going to do a thing. Take all my money. And then we're like all disappointed because they didn't make a thing and they didn't have the expertise and they didn't. So yeah, lots of reasons why developers might not know what they want, but I think there's also this idea of they know what they want, but they can't do it.
Sure.
So sure. Yeah. Oh, what a great discussion.
Well, thank everyone for joining us for this discussion, episode 121 of the backward-compatible.com podcast, or talk about whether or not developers might not know what they want all the time.
They don't.
They don't. Neither do players. Nobody knows what they want. We need somebody just to like tell us what we should do.
I definitely don't know what Jim wants.
I don't either. Yeah. Tell me if you find out.
I'll know when I see it. Anyway, thank you for joining us, everyone. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.